So we've had a lot of data. We've had a lot of opportunities to think about the effects of mandates and the effects of real-life policies out there in the world. What I want to present to you now is where we move to a more conceptual part of the discussion, and we start thinking about, well, what are mandates? And for those of you who were here a couple of years ago when I started to share some very early thoughts as I developed this program of research, what you're now seeing is the result of at least a good year spent thinking and talking, in particular with my collaborator Mark, who you'll be hearing from in a moment. And this is the very kind of formative stage of my three-year comparative work funded by the Australian government to look at mandates in Australia, Italy, France and California. If you're wondering what all of those countries have or jurisdictions have in common, at the time that I applied for the grant, they had all very recently gone for a restrictive model of mandate with only medical exemptions. They'd got rid of everything else, or they had somehow in other ways tightened their mandatory regime system or expanded it such that they were all comparable cases of jurisdictions where there were going to be consequences for you and your family if you chose to reject vaccines. So what I'm sharing with you is a paper that has just been published last week in Milbank Quarterly, but it's peppered with some new insights. I've been doing field work in Italy and France directly before landing in this part of France. So I'll also be sharing some very early insights from that research that, of course, is not published yet. So, I'm a political scientist, and that means that I'm particularly interested in the relationship between the government and the governed, and that's us. I want to point out at the beginning that there's an intermediary stage to that, and that is, of course, that other people get governed, health professionals get governed, people running daycare centres may get governed in order to produce an outcome in the ultimate population that is the target of these interventions, and that's the parents. But this particular work was just us beginning to think about that relationship between the state and the individual. But I'll return a bit later to this idea of intermediaries who may also get picked up and governed in that process. So I'm sure I don't need to elaborate to this audience, and in fact Sada's just demonstrated this, that there is so much you can do, and we heard a wonderful example about this from Sweden in the previous session. There is a whole bunch of stuff governments can, should and must be doing before they even think about making vaccination mandatory in any way. And there are models from around the world where we have free and efficient programs accompanied by persuasion, and vaccination is a voluntary act by parents. So that's one way. If I'm talking in big, broad brushstrokes, that's one way to govern vaccination uptake. Another one, as Sada's just talked about, is this idea of permissive mandates. And I want to stress as well that permissiveness is a continuum, and Saad talks about the Goldilocks point as being fairly far along that continuum. We don't just give them out like candy, but ultimately you are allowed to opt out if you want to, if you're willing to go through the hoops. And then we have my jurisdictions that I'm looking at, and I'm closely watching both Germany and the UK, as well as, of course, I haven't mentioned the additional US states that have gone down this path this year. And this is the restrictive model. It's medical exemption or you're going to be facing consequences for refusal. So who is being governed? Again, it won't come as any surprise to this group to know, because we've been talking about it for years, that there are two different types of groups that are under-vaccinated. And these are the access group and the acceptance group, and that they are such different groups. But I'm going to make a point of emphasising this, because one of the dramatic things I've learned in the last 2 weeks and that I'm still processing is that while this is part of our bread and butter in Australia, we talk about this all the time, and what I've been reflecting on is how important research is that makes us reflect on that, that makes policymakers fluent in the knowledge and understanding of these groups, and that if your jurisdiction doesn't measure this, if your jurisdiction does not know the social profile of the under-vaccinated, you could very well be in a position of not thinking about both these groups when you mandate, and I have seen evidence of this in the last fortnight. So, anyway, I'm not going to go on about them now because you know what they are, but I'm going to say that within the acceptance, of course, there are two subgroups, which is the rusted-on anti-vax, we think we'll never change their mind, but we might still want to impose consequences on them. And then there's hesitant parents who might be swayed to change their behaviour. And then I had this query about possibly against their beliefs. So you can shove someone fairly far in a certain direction against their will, and if you're using the lever that works on them, you'll change their behaviour without changing their mind. But again, one of the things that has emerged a lot for me in the last 2 weeks of fieldwork is that there is sort of mixed discourses around, well, maybe we're also actually changing their minds. Maybe mandates are also actually changing these people's minds, and I'm happy to elaborate on that in the discussion. So these are all the groups being governed, and what I want to be clear about is, and I just alluded to this, but you know, we don't know whether governments who introduce mandates are thinking about this level of nuance. Are they thinking about these three different groups? Because they are three different groups, even if the acceptance category could be perhaps piled together in some circumstances. Because, like it or not, they will all be being governed one way or another by the policy you introduce. And so, are you governing the people you meant to govern? Are you accidentally governing some other people you didn't even know existed? So these are really important questions. There are more. So my comparative work is looking, excuse me, at mandates in different jurisdictions. And there are different kinds of mandates. And so one of the things that Mark and I have looked at in our paper is this question of timeliness. So if the instrument you've chosen is school entry, guess what? You're probably not going to find your vaccines are delivered and the timing that you would recommend that the infant receives them, because the crucial moment that it's getting kind of checked and monitored is school entry. And maybe if you have them for, like in Australia, we have a mandate that operates from birth. Now, say what you will about that mandate, the one thing it does cover is timeliness. Who's excluded? Does the lever affect all income groups or service users? So in Australia, many of you probably know, we have a mandate that operates through our social security system. If you're a high income earner, you are not governed by that mandate. You are explicitly excluded from being held to account, if you like, to the collective for your decision. If you're on a middle or low income, you will face that consequence. And then to go back to that question of access and acceptance, Mark and I thought a lot and talked a lot. I remember our many detailed conversations and rewrites around how mandates work on all these different kind of subgroups of people. And of course, a mandate, as Saad talked about, a mandate with like lots of hoops to jump through, but ultimately you can get an exemption. That's really kind of aimed at basic social compliance. So you're nudging the sort of vulnerable along to go and get the vaccine, but you're allowing those who really don't want to opt out. But again, in my home country of Australia, our mandates, I think particularly the federal no jab, no pay policy, no play policy, the one linked to social welfare, I think really has been more about targeting and punishing refusers. So it was crafted with those people in mind. And I note particularly that we already had the other kind of mandate first before we got rid of our personal belief or philosophical exemption, which then meant the mandate got harder and was much more about targeting refusers. Just excuse me a moment. Some jobs take two hands. Okay. So, moving on to our taxonomy. We came up with the five S's, and I'm going to introduce you to four of them. Scope, and I'll take you through them in more detail. But scope, which vaccines are mandated, sanctions, what happens if you don't, severity, how bad is it, selectivity, and selectivity is really important. It's about enforcement and it's about exemption, which can be deliberate decisions made by government from the top, or it can be, hey, out there in the field, as Saad alluded to, maybe we're just not really doing it. These combined together determine salience, which is really how burdensome is the mandate. Remember, this project is about the governance of the individual, the parent. So it's a question of is whatever's cooked up between these other four S's going to make me more likely to vaccinate? This schema enables us to compare over time, to talk about a country's mandate becoming perhaps more salient as one of these aspects is tweaked. It also, I hope, will allow me to compare the jurisdictions. So once I truly know what's happening on the ground in each of these places, I will be able to better talk about, do a comparative notion of salience between them. Scope, which vaccines? Italy has made a whole bunch of vaccines mandatory very recently. Belgium has one vaccine that is mandatory. And France moved from 3 to 11 in a similar sort of fashion to Italy. But the important thing to note from the French story, and PS, it's complicated, I'm vastly oversimplifying it here. But as those of us who were here a couple of years ago learned, one of the reasons they needed to do it is they had this weird historic legacy combination of some vaccines that were mandatory but not really enforced, and some vaccines that were recommended, because that was the new wave of how vaccination was being governed. It was like, you know, the kind of persuasion provision model. Now, when they made their decision to go from 3 to 11, they did a whole bunch of studies, they did a whole bunch of analysis, they did a whole bunch of consultation. But ultimately, one of the things that really, and so what was on the table was like complete removal of mandates, and they looked to Europe for that, and I think in particular they looked to England, and they were like, we're a bit weird that we're mandating some. We want to be more like everyone else. On the other hand, they were super attuned to the signal that goes out when a government removes a mandate. So this is another interesting part of my work. How do you ever remove a mandate? Because what does that say? What does it say to remove a mandate? It's not important. Okay. So what I want to be clear on is that decisions about mandates are not epidemiological, or at least not directly. You might be thinking about the epidemiological consequences, but they are also decisions around messaging and being afraid of sending bad messages that can have, ultimately, epidemiological consequences. Sanctions. What happens if you don't vaccinate? Mark and I considered these options, which I'm not going to elaborate in too much detail. I've talked about versions of them, except to say we don't think this one exists, but we thought about it as a governance mechanism, because states, if they wanted, could make it easy for you to sue someone. I mean, it's kind of a ludicrous idea. It's probably a long way away. But if states wanted to, for example, they could legislate to lower the burden of proof. And that's a way states could get involved in helping citizens hold other citizens accountable for the spread of disease. It's not a policy recommendation, guys, but it's us thinking about all the different ways states could get involved. These exclusion from the collective mandates are, of course, what we see in the US, which Saad predominantly talked about, but they're also in some Australian states and in Italy and in France. And there can be sort of more powerful arguments, perhaps, for these kinds of mandates, which I'm happy to elaborate on in the question time. And then, of course, loss of financial entitlements, as discussed in my own country. So now this question of selectivity. How are people exempted and who is exempted? So one thing that's clear is that all regimes have medical exemptions. But because my project is all about diving deep, deep, deep and trying to find out what exactly happens on the ground, we also know that not all medical exemptions are created the same across jurisdictions. Generally within a country like the US, they probably are, but you know, there are very different ways. And we saw in California, and we're seeing the results of it, that when there is wiggle room for doctors to be more involved as opposed to following a very tight checklist, there of course is then room for cottage industries of practitioners to spring up and perhaps cater to demand in the community for a wider range of exemptions. And you only need to see the discourse adopted by the parents opposing California's SB 276, which really tightened up scrutiny of medical exemptions in that state, to see that a bunch of people that look pretty much like anti-vax and vax refusers had been somehow sheltering under this category of medical exemption. I'm not going to go over the other ones too much, in fact, at all, because I think Saad has already done that. I just want to jump straight to the last one, which is mirage mandates, and a new concept I'm just trotting out today because I just sort of came up with a frame for it last night at midnight working on my slides. So mirage mandate. This is a mandate that looks like a mandate if you just walk past it, but if you stop and have a closer look, it's not really a mandate. So in the Australian state of Queensland, and this is interesting because the Australian states have all kind of adopted versions of the same thing, which is like the daycare mandate, your kid must be vaccinated for you to come in, no personal belief, conscientious objection. Queensland went their own way. They did something different. They said, hey, childcare providers, you can exclude if you want. It's your call. And they didn't put anything in place to kind of, you know, advise people on the appropriateness of doing so or otherwise. It was just kind of left to that person's discretion as to whether to do it. I've got to go in and do more work in Queensland, but the evidence I can find so far is that this has not been picked up by the providers. They're not doing it. Other Australian states have told childcare providers, you will exclude. and they are. Okay, so Queensland is a mirage mandate, but I've since been flirting with this idea of megaphone mandates. And this is because when I go in and do my discussion and analysis with policy makers and those who are tasked with implementing policy, they often talk about law, and in fact I see laws passed in parliaments, that then when I look to the implementation, there's weird little things that are buried in regulations, or regulations are never written, and in fact the law does not even necessarily come with an enforcement mechanism. And so I talk to people about, well, why are you writing a law that's not really a law? It's not quite a mirage mandate, because it sort of looks much more like a law and perhaps indeed behaves like a law, and that I think is the point. And I'm still puzzling this one out a bit, but I think a megaphone mandate is a signal that tells people what to do and tells people that it's important and makes people think something bad might happen if they don't, but actually perhaps it doesn't. And I've got some more stories from this last couple of weeks that kind of have further got me thinking about this megaphone mandates. So you put scope, sanctions and their severity, those two are kind of linked obviously, selectivity together, and you come up with salience. So this is our rather poorly enlarged diagram of that. And so you end up with salience, and that's, like I said, that big question of how burdensome is the policy / is it going to make me vaccinate? There are more things to consider though. As I said, the focus of this work, and what we're now doing is kind of expanding the scope of how we think about the governance of vaccine refusal and acceptance, because there's more players that this work hasn't looked at. So if we were to think actually more broadly about what should governments think about, this is where we start to bring in some of this other stuff. So when Australia abolished our conscientious objection, when we made our mandate more salient by saying, guess what, you can't just not vaccinate anymore by saying you don't want to and following a bureaucratic procedure, we lost an opportunity for medical professionals to counsel refusing parents, and we also stopped gathering data on who they were, and so that we could know who was under-vaccinated. So Julie and Margie have written this really important paper that has that as a clear consequence in Australia. There's other considerations, of course. If we're thinking like governments, we're thinking about money. We're thinking about how much do these various interventions cost. You know, Saad talked about his Goldilocks sweet spot warm shower moment being that you sit down and have a session with a professional, with someone qualified to vaccinate you. The other model, of course, is that you go to an education session and sit down with a bunch of parents to be lectured by a professional. If you think about those two different models, the one where you get sit down and lectured by someone from the state, there is a high level of control over the information they're giving you, right? But it's expensive for the state. So with high control comes high cost. They can outsource that to an extent, depending on how privatised primary care is. But if they privatise it and send it out into the community and you find your own paediatrician or your own GP to lecture you, again, we see perhaps cottage industry of people who set themselves up to give you what you're looking for, which is a signature in a box. So, yeah, so there's a price either way. Of course, as again, I just wanted to remind this because it's so important, there are alternative modes of governance that can bring about the results that people are looking for, perhaps when they introduce mandates. These are not only crucial that you did all this before you even thought about it, but also they're crucial that you keep doing this even if you mandate. And again, this is something I'm happy to talk about more in the discussion. And then, so Chomsky talks about the manufacturing of consent in a really negative way, right? But when I think about the word consent for vaccination, of course, it's not such a negative idea that you would have people agreeing to this really important health intervention. So I've been thinking recently about this idea that if you, of course, are going to have a mandate and it's going to hurt some people, it's going to bite them, it's going to squeeze them, it's going to feel horrible for them. The onus is on you, the state, to do all of this stuff so that that group is as tiny as you can possibly make it, right? Like that's absolutely incumbent on you to do that. So I mentioned that the way we're starting to think about, and the future research and the research we're doing, is now to think about, well, who are all these other intermediaries who are being drawn into this web of governance, of imposing consequences, of imposing penalties, not just perhaps on the parents, of course, but on the doctor who gives the fraudulent medical exemption, or on the daycare provider who lets the kid in when they weren't supposed to, and how these agents become co-opted into the project of governing vaccine refusal and acceptance in these jurisdictions. So that's the end of my presentation. And I will now introduce Mark Navin, my collaborator, who's pretty much going to pick up where I left off, but take us somewhere else. Thank you.